Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podcasting alongside me this week are, back from East Halls, Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
George Cran.
Hello.
And the man who's going to have most to say, but will be kind to him, Alan Temple.
Hello, hello, hello.
Suitably sort of dulcet tones there from you, Alan, because bad days at Tannadice.
Oh, dire. And the way
to ease
that
you, in there. You just went right in, dire.
Oh, no.
That is. You're quite
no.
Right.
Well, there's no point sugarcoating any aspect of it. Not only is there impending relegation, the culmination of a woeful campaign, but the nature in which it got confirmed on Wednesday evening just sort of encapsulated everything that's been bad about Dundee United this season. Having been told by the manager for the previous three games, keep shooting ourselves in the foot, keep giving teams a head start, they did exactly that. The first goal is mind-boggling by Loy Kina, a player I've got a lot of time for and I think he'll have a fabulous career. Just crazy. Gets lucky dribbling away from two players in his own box and then, I don't know, decides to beat another couple. And that leads to the first goal. Obviously, that affects confidence. Second goal, woeful as well. So, but that's one game. Dundee United haven't been relegated on the basis of one game. They've been relegated on the basis of a season that's been littered with errors like the ones we saw at Tannadice on Wednesday evening, and more alarming than the goals conceded. Just Jim Goodwin said they were outfought after the game, and that's absolutely unforgivable. Unforgivable that when that much is at stake, when you've got 10,000 supporters at Tannadice, that the other team was willing to fight harder than you. And see, when the manager's saying that, then the game's up. The whole squad needs a revamp, needs a rebuild. And we'll maybe get on to how challenging that could be a little bit later. But it's, the game's a bogey when a team can't get up and can't fight hard for their Premiership status.
I mean, like you said, I watched most of the match later. I listened to it on the radio, then I watched most of it on the Gaelic channel. Don't get me started. But United just didn't offer anything. It was such a nothing performance that it was. I was quite stunned. But they're just a lack of pace to their game, a lack of anything.
Yeah, it's Rory McLeod hit the post late on, but it was 3-0 by that point. In terms of shots on target, Dundee United had one shot on target. But the bottom line is they've reached this stage of the season fighting for their lives in theory, and part of the reason why they've got nothing going forward is because they've got nothing going forward. Yeah. They've had to effectively strap up Stephen Fletcher and send him out there. Jim Goodwin described it at 70% fitness. I would be surprised if it's as high as 70% fitness. My understanding into Wednesday is Stephen Fletcher wasn't playing in that football match. And it's a credit to Stephen that he clearly has been willing to put his hand up and say, do you know what, just put me in for however long I'll last. And for him to last 90 minutes is a testament to him. He didn't have his best game, I don't think, in the circumstances I would have expected him to have his best game. But he can at least hold his head high in terms of the effort he's put in to get out there. But there's no other options. Dundee United, over the course of this season, sold more than 250 senior goals. And allowing Tony Watt to leave in January and allowing Nicky Clark to go to St Johnstone. So they've done absolutely nothing to replace those goals. So we can't all be shocked when we get to this stage of the season and there's a lack of attacking impetus. This campaign of recruitment from Dundee United has been a catastrophe. They've not filled voids that have been completely obvious the defensive midfield void, and how many times have we mentioned it on this show, has been obvious since Jean Dufoux left what's that now, 18 months ago, and it has never been filled. And Jim Goodwin alluded to the lack of dogs in his team when he spoke to the club media last night. And you honestly, you felt like screaming, because I remember asking Jack Ross that question and being told, oh, well, you know, it's not about specific sorts of players. It's about the way a team plays, and we want the players to be able to do a bit of everything. And it didn't ring true then, and it doesn't ring true now. So they needed that. They needed a fast centre-half. They didn't sort that until January. And they needed backup to the 36-year-old striker. And they didn't sort that out. The squad is unbalanced. It has gaps positionally. It has a lack of balance in terms of characters, which, you know, there's a lot of, you know, this isn't a bad dressing room. This isn't a dressing room of bad boys. It's a, they're nice lads. They're all very polite, nice, technical footballers, and therein lies your problem. They could do with a couple of, I'm trying not to swear. They could do with a couple characters. They could do a couple of tough, who absolutely despise
the PG version.
Yeah, they need players that despise losing football matches. They need players who are furious when they get beat, that kick the door off the hinges and
kick the opposition.
You know, you don't want a dressing. You don't want a dressing room full of them, but a couple might be nice. And I feel like this is a team that's been relegated because of squad building, and from
we've been saying it all season. It's about gaps, isn't it? There's a lot of players there you would keep, but like you say, there are big bits missing, aren't there?
Yeah, and as I say, you feel like screaming, because this isn't, it's not even particularly incisive analysis. These things have been blatantly obvious for a period of time now, and the fact that they weren't addressed in January smacks of an arrogance and an unwillingness to accept that the club were in a relegation battle. It's, I understand that United had effectively, you know, spent their budget going into January, and that's understandable, fair enough. However, plenty of clubs spend their budget before January, and when they're in a relegation battle, guess what? You draw a new budget because it's a hell of a lot more expensive to get relegated from the Premiership than it is to
overspend
50-60 grand on getting a loan player or a free transfer or something like that. So you still had people talking about finishing in the top six at supporters meetings and things, you know, and the whole vibe smacks of a total unwillingness to accept the plight that the club had got itself into. There was this feeling that we've got good players. It's that cliche that I genuinely believe this club for too long thought they were too good to go down, and they do have some lovely footballers and they have some talented guys in there, but they're not a team. They're not a team in a million years, and that shows when they capitulate 9-7-4-4. It's that is what a team doesn't do. And there's I was going to call it an irony. It's not an irony, it's perfectly appropriate that the reason why we're talking about Dundee United effectively being relegated rather than just needing the results to go their way is because of that goal difference. It's because of that goal difference swing compared to Ross County, and that goal difference is so damaging because they've capitulated at times this season. They shipped 4 at Ross County. They shipped 9 against Celtic. See, if that team just had a little bit more gumption, a little bit more fighting spirit, and were a bit more of a team, maybe they would have shut down those games. Maybe those would have been 2-goal defeats and 5-goal defeats. And then all they would need...
Yeah, they're a team when they're 2 down after 70 minutes. You expect it to go to 3. You don't expect them to score.
100%. Yeah, and particularly the early stage of the season, I've never known a team so open to counter attacks. Poor Craig Sibbald's been asked to play like Patrick Vieira, and it's, you know, he's a very combative, hard working player, but it's not his game, and it never has been. And the reasons why United have been relegated, and there are obviously micro regions in terms of the individual errors and team selections along the way, but in terms of the macro reason why Dundee United have been relegated, it's because of a dismal attempt at building a squad for this season.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Bear, was it... Did it come out... Jim Goodwin's done a very good job of defending his players, talking up his players, but did his team selection last night sum up his thoughts, maybe private thoughts on the squad when he binned the experienced goalie for a kid and basically rolled Stephen Fletcher off a stretcher to get him on?
Desperate state of affairs to get yourself into. And Alan touched on, you know, the lack of a striking help for Fletcher and defensive midfielder, but he never spoke about the goalkeeping situation, which the club are just as culpable for. You know, when Eriksen went at Christmas, they should have been out and got himself a job in pro. They could have done that, I would think, well within a budget, even though, you know, it would have cost him a few thousand pounds here and there. But to leave himself open to bringing Jack Newman in, a kid, effectively, for a game like that, you know, it was just ridiculous. And let's hope that he's not affected by or any of the other young players who were on the park last night, because that was a toxic situation to find themselves in, and obviously having to walk off that pitch, you know. But I mean, to be fair, a lot of the fans had actually left by that point, by full time.
We've seen what it can do at United. I remember in Craig Brewster's time, there was a few kids came on into the team in the final few games, and we're never seen again.
It wasn't a pleasant situation to find himself in, and it just shows you the hand that Jim Goodwin was left with. You know, they came from nowhere, Jim Goodwin. Those three wins, you know, they weren't playing brilliant football, Tom. They were getting a bit of rub of the green, which they were probably due, but they took it and they got themselves out of the mire at the bottom, but they only put themselves back into that pocket. And now they've lost four games on the spin, and I don't know what the stats are. Somebody might be able to dig them up going forward, but has any team actually lost five games after the split in the bottom half? I don't know. Dundee went pretty close there.
Did Dundee do it?
Dundee
might have been four in a draw.
But, you know, it was...
Because I think they were in seventh at the time.
It was desperate. It's desperate, desperate times for Dundee United. And you know, as we all documented on here, I'm a Dundee fan, but... You know, I've certainly mellowed over the years, and it's a bad day for...
It's a bad day for the
bad
city.
Bad day for Dundee United fans, bad day for the club. But you're right, it is a bad day for the city. I mean, you think of things that are going on in this city, whether it's, you know, the V&A, Discovery, the universities, the big weekend's on this weekend. Anything that can raise the profile of the city is a good thing. Having two clubs in the top flight raises the profile of the city. There's no doubt about that. Absolutely no doubt about that.
And thank God for Ailish McColgan. Otherwise, it's the city of sport and failure almost. And Dundee have been promoted, to be fair, but it just feels that
there's
way.
There's also the financial aspect, because you're missing out on the big hitters, Celtic, Rangers, Aberdeen, Hearts, Hibs coming to the city on a far more regular basis. Almost every second week they would be in the city.
Two weeks ago, the pubs and shops on the Clipway Road would be going, Dundee promoted, United are getting better.
Absolutely.
Every Saturday during the football season's a good day.
Revenue pouring in.
And now they're like, nothing's changed.
Not to mention four Derby matches.
Yeah.
Which are big, big money spinners, big for...
Four Derby matches, £500,000 each, not each game. £500,000 for the two clubs from their two home games.
You know what we're
disaster.
I mean, we've seen it. We saw it at Dens last season. What, Queen's Park coming to Dundee, Cove Rangers coming to Dundee, Hamilton Accies coming to Dundee. Come on, it's a different world.
Well, I heard Malky Mackay on the radio last night, paying tribute to the Ross County fans. And fair enough, it's his club. He's talking them up. But he was saying, he was raving about, I think they thought they had 500 at Tangerines.
Yeah.
That's a huge away support for Ross County.
Yeah.
Dundee were complaining at getting 1,100 tickets for their final league
game. That's what people have to realise, and that's the bigger picture I'm looking at. And you know, Andy Walker made a point on Sky. It's a big city club who haven't been able to keep up with the likes of Livingston's, the St Mirren's, the St Johnston's, clubs who shouldn't have the same, or certainly didn't have the same budget, but find themselves still in the Premier League this season. It's a problem that both Dundee clubs now have. They can't keep themselves in there. And, I mean, there's going to be... The worrying aspect is there's obviously going to have to be big cuts at Tan. There's absolutely no doubt about that. Unless the chairman stands up, the owner stands up and says, I'm going to pump in a lot more money. He's already pumped in a fair amount of money, Tom. I would be very surprised if he's willing to put in the same amount going forward. There are going to have to be cuts, and that might mean cuts, obviously, on the playing staff, but also behind the scenes at times, the people who work in the offices. You just don't know about these things, and this is what it all means. This is what relegation actually means, yeah. You know. So it's a bad day for the city all around.
I do. I mean, I feel for the owner, Mark Ogren, and I saw you got. I certainly saw online him getting a wee bit of stick last night, but at the same time, it strikes me, is it looking at both sides of Tannadice Street, should Americans only be allowed to buy a British sports club when they understand what the meaning of the word relegation is? Because it's not a big thing in American sport, relegation. And they seem, but I mean, to go back specifically
to Mark... I'd do that to the players as well. Do they really understand what relegation means?
Uh-huh.
Because it looked to me as though some of them didn't.
No.
With the performance they put on.
But I go back to Ogren and on the way in and sitting having my breakfast this morning, I was thinking about it, because sadly I've seen plenty of relegations in my time in this city. One thing that strikes me about this one, and it's maybe worrying, there's a failure at every level. Ogren bought the club and said, I'm going to make a profit, good in, and bring regular European football. They're relegated. Tony Ashgar was his day-to-day chief. He's gone. They've had three managers this season, as Alan's touched on extensively there. They've not got the balance of their squad right. I mean, you can go boardroom, day-to-day management of the club, day-to-day management of the team in the dressing room. I mean, it's everything's gone wrong this season. It's not just like one thing's gone wrong and they haven't been able to recover from it. I mean, basically, we've been optimistic in recent weeks, and I sort of ask, how stupid am I? Because how could they escape when there were so many problems in each department of the club, if you like?
Yes, I mean, is it any surprise the finished bottom of just what you've said, Tom? There's none really, isn't there? I mean, I don't know where they go going forward. I mean, it's they're going to have take a deep breath, let the dust settle slightly, and then sit down and map out a plan to come back. Kilmarnock have shown you can bounce back. Dundee have shown you can bounce back. But there's no guarantees in football term. There's absolutely none. Dundee United have got to go and do it, and it's a tough gig, but they've just got to get the heads down and move on from this. But it's going to be really tough.
And I turn to my contract expert, George Cran, here as well. The irony is, we'll talk later about Dundee. We're worried that Dundee don't have players in contract. The problem for United could be they've got too many players in big, good, lucrative contracts. And these guys might say, well, in an ideal world, I'd help you out by moving on. But I've got bills to pay.
Somebody else has to pick up the contract,
I can't get a contract like the one I've got here, so you're stuck with me. It could be a very, very costly season, hopefully a season, next season in the Championship for United. And that's been optimistic, because last time it took them four seasons to get out.
Yeah, well, I can't imagine they're going to have the same sort of budget to get out this time as they did when Ogren first came in. They spent a lot of money to get that team out of the Premiership, the Championship, sorry. And I don't see him seeing the point in doing it again, because it's cost him so much money to get the club up, and suddenly they've gone back down. But in terms of the players, you've got guys on big contracts, decent money, very decent money, but they've absolutely not performed this season. So why would the competition decide to give them that same money? If they haven't? I think Stephen Fletcher might be okay, because he's done all right in a team that, as Alan has said, hasn't functioned.
Stephen Fletcher probably deserves, and a couple of others deserve, bonuses for managing to get it to the last day of the season, mathematically.
Are you going to give them those bonuses?
No, that's... I'll always spend a millionaire's money, but never my own. But
the budget for next season is going to be, far, far smaller. In terms of last night, I just saw a team absolutely lacking in confidence. Obviously, that comes with the runs they've been on, but as soon as they lost the goal, the manner and the way they lost the goal was a team without confidence, and they just didn't have any confidence that they could get that back. And I think that comes from the whole myriad of reasons you give, Tam and Alan's gave throughout the season, that there's been so much wrong that I think the players just accepted their fate last night, I have to say. And just going back to Alan's point on Dundee United not expecting to be in this position, you listen to Derek McInnes's post-match comments, and he's going on about finishing 10th is a successful season for Kilmarnock, very successful, because they were expecting to be in this position. Ross County were expecting to be in this position, fighting for their lives. And United, it seems to have taken them by surprise, but I don't think it's taken the fans by surprise or anyone else watching.
Might have taken the owner by surprise. I mean, Alan, you're the man with your finger on the pulse at, or our man with his finger on the pulse at Tannerice. What is your feeling about the kind of commitment Mark Ogren will continue to give?
I think if Mark Ogren could get out, he would get out, to be perfectly honest. I think, however, I don't think he is at the stage, or prior to relegation certainly, I wasn't hearing that he was at the stage where he'd be willing to accept a pittance. I don't think he was at the stage where he was willing to say, do you know what, I'm just going to write this off and walk away. He was keen to get what he would describe as market value. What that would be now for a club that owes, well, according to the accounts of 2022, owes £13.1 million to creditors, albeit he is said creditors for the most part. And now in the Championship and weighed down by some hefty contracts and an impending complete collapse of revenue streams, what the price of Dundee United would be now is a fascinating question. And he's got a really tough decision to make. He's between a rock and a hard place, because anybody that would be countenancing buying Dundee United at the moment isn't going to be thinking about spending big money on it. So he's going to probably have to say, I'm going to have to take a bath on this and walk away. I've enjoyed my adventure, but you know what? It was a money pit. Or he's going to have to fund them trying to get out of the Championship. And either way, and that is such a big risk, because who's to say 3 years down the line, that creditor column doesn't say 20 million and he's lost even more? You know, it's a really unenviable position that Mark Ogren's in. And the contracts speak to a club that didn't give a single second's consideration to relegation as well. The lengths of them, you know, Tony Watt, 25, Middleton, 20-25, Joom, Levitt, Mulgrew, Behic, Eriksson, Birigiti, 24. None of these guys are out. So I just, it's a huge concern. And, you know, those big attendances you're talking about, when you add them all up, you're talking about losing millions purely on attendance revenue before you get into any sort of sponsorship, TV, all that sort of thing. This is a minor financial catastrophe for Dundee United. And while I do appreciate, and you said it a few times over the course of the season, Tam, you know, that you maybe feel a wee bit sorry for Mark Ogren, and you know, you can't argue with the amount of money he's put in. Of course, true, but I feel like we're in danger of patronising him when we do that sometimes. Fundamentally, he is a businessman. This is his business.
And he's failed.
And the decisions that are made, and the decisions that are made directly below him are on him.
He is the one
that signed off on Tony Ashgar, Jack Ross and the executive team building this squad, which in my view is a squad where they tried to walk before they could run, and they completely threw the baby out with the bathwater in chase of, you know, whatever they thought they might get, European group stage football or a top four finish. And that foolhardiness has resulted in relegation, and blame has to go right up the chain. And it's effectively cost Tony Ashgar his job. It's cost Jack Ross's job. It's cost Liam Fox's job. It has seen the financial chief, Derek Bond, leave the club. There is, although it's completely opaque in terms of whether that would be a direct consequence of United's fortunes this season, but nevertheless, he has also gone. So there is accountability right up the chain, right up and down the chain, and that has to go right up to Mark Ogren, because this season has been a disaster, and it's patronising to him to paint him as this, genial figure who's, you know, signing checks and a bit disassociated with things. Because see, if that is the case, that he's running his business badly.
Yeah, aye. So for clarification, Alan, because what you say is right. Just for everyone here, and Bear's known me longest. All I've discovered is a bit of humanity. 20 years ago, I'd have been for burning them all at the stake. Now I've got sympathy for them, but you're right. They have failed. The players have failed. The managers have failed. The people that were running the club day-to-day have failed, and the owner has failed. I mean, one of the things I was thinking about saying is, it's what amazes me about Mark Ogren, and again, I, as I say, as I got older, I can still have sympathy, but it strikes me that he bought a football club and then thought, what am I going to do with it? Because he appointed Tony Asghar, and nothing against Tony Asghar, but I would never dream of meeting someone for the first time and the task was to help me find the thing I wanted to buy. And then that's the person I turn around to and say, oh, do you want to run it for me? To me, that if you're going to buy a football club, before you've bought a football club, you have in your mind who's, if it's not going to be you that runs it day to day, someone's going to run it day to day. You should be, what I'm saying is, you should have a plan about once the purchase is complete, this is what, how the operation will work. And that didn't seem to be the case. And I think they've maybe paid the price for that in the sense that bits have been added on here and there as they've gone along. So I totally agree with you. I don't defend them from failure. I'm just not as bitter as I used to be. Speak, Alan. I know it's tough, but you can do it.
No, I think the next big question we're going to have is obviously the position of the manager.
Yeah, I was going to ask
it was that. Interesting that that, you know, after the game, when he could quite easily have straight batted the question about his future, mm-hmm. that would be easily done because he hadn't properly sat down with Mark Ogren and he still has a game to manage on Sunday. But he didn't. He basically said he wants to be the guy that sorts out Dundee United, I think was the word they used. And there's plenty of sorting out to be done. But I would say that Jim's not due to be absolved from this. He was the manager of a football club that was on a decent run going into the split and then completely capitulated after the split. And he tried a lot of things and fundamentally none of them worked. And he, you know, as a coach, I'm sure will take a degree of the blame for that. But then again, when you look at some of the mistakes the players made, you do mm-hmm. think to yourself, like, I'm not sure how you coach a player.
I thought,
you know, not to do something
after
incredibly
Saturday's
stupid.
Game, I thought it came through that he'd had enough of the basic errors.
Yeah. So, and I think, you know, fans will have their own opinions, and it's not up to me to tell, you know, them who the right appointment would be. If it were me, I would give Jim Goodwin the job. I think he has brought an air of positivity about the place that wasn't there. I think he's a good motivator. During that winning run and even a couple of draws, which they could have won, I thought you saw a team that had a little bit of verve, had a little bit of fight, that fell off a cliff. So that obviously puts a question mark there. But I look at the situation he came into, 4 points adrift, morale absolutely through the floor. I look at, you know, the mood he managed to bring about the place, even if it was rather temporarily. And I also look at the lack of viable options I see out there at the moment.
Yeah, that's a big thing.
I'm not sure who they get better than Jim Goodwin to manage a Dundee United team in the Championship with a staggering amount of admin and rebuilding to be done.
Yeah, I must admit,
he's in the building.
I remember he was by no means the greatest ever Dundee United manager, but I remember when Alex Smith came in and the team still struggled, but he came in at United. He was a real manager. He was a real football manager. He got the club back operating like a football club should. And it has crossed my mind with that Jim Goodwin, good or bad results, he's a real manager. They're operating like a football team. They're operating like a squad and like a club. And maybe Bear, at a time when, basically, as Alan and I have alluded to, when there are faults at every level of the club, they should maybe grab the real manager while they can.
Well, there's a couple of sides to that, Tom. One is Jim Goodwin. I mean, I take it his contract ends now, Alan. It was just a short-term deal to the end of the season, as far as we're aware. Is the contract that's going to...
After Sunday, yeah, effectively.
So, obviously, they'll have to offer him a new contract. What will that contract be? Will Jim Goodwin say, well, if you want me, I'm sorry, you're going to have to pay a wee bit more? He might still think his stock is reasonable enough to get another appointment. I think it was a massive gamble for Jim Goodwin.
Dundee, have you heard someone?
Well, I think he could be in the...
That no, won't happen.
No.
Well, he was close before.
Yeah,
that's why it won't happen again.
I said at the time I thought it was a massive gamble for Jim Goodwin coming back so soon, taking over at Dundee United when they were in such a precarious position. He obviously backed himself, you know, that he could do the job, but unfortunately it has backfired. So he's got unenviable...
He's maybe the smallest loser of everyone at Tannadice. He's certainly not a winner, but...
He's got the unenviable record now, you know, having been sacked at Aberdeen this season and taking Dundee United into the Championship. It doesn't matter how you sort of, as Alan says, sugarcoat it. That's exactly what's happened. Now, like we say, I think had Jim Goodwin taken a back seat at this point in time, he would have been number one candidate for quite a few jobs, I've got
probably
to say.
Probably the United job.
Yes, and he might have been given a bit more time to actually build a team there. But it'll be interesting to see where Dundee United go. Jim Goodwin obviously comes as a double act with his assistant, who
Lee Sharp,
who's followed him. So
former Dundee left back.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. It is a case of what sort of contract could United put under his nose that will attract him to take
the job. Has been interesting him from down south.
And as I say, that's something that they're going to have to get their heads around. But I said, take a deep breath. But they're going to have to do things quickly now and figure out how do they make that. What is their plan of attack for next season? I mean, they do get the parachute payment, but that will be gobbled up very, very quickly with the amount of guys they've actually still got in contract. Players are going to leave Tannadice.
Mark Ogren's plane players tickets will take care of that.
Players are going to leave Tannadice. Mark my words, the squad you see next season will bear absolutely no resemblance.
Ah, because players will want to.
Yes, absolutely. So things will change. They'll have one or two very useful young players. What they want to make sure of is that these players aren't sort of tempted away by other things as well. I take it they will be on contract anyway. But they need to get their head around that one. Whether it is Jim Goodwin, who I think, Alan, I think you're right. Is there a better, a more experienced manager out there to get them back up? I mean, if you guys can think of one, I mean, I can't think of one off the top of my head.
Like Alan says, there's blame there. And Jim Goodwin said that. He takes his responsibility. But I would say right now, he represents their best chance of promotion next season.
Yeah, I think so. But there's a lot of things to be sorted out before they get to that point.
Do you know, a strange thought, just talking about promotion next season. United will be red hot favourites. And then, George, someone who knows the Championship well, there'll actually be a few Championship clubs very disappointed. And will it affect their spending? Yeah. Because a lot of Championship clubs won't expect to finish above United next season.
I would still suggest, I mean, we've spoken about budgets and they're going to have to cut their cloth massively. Yeah. Massively. But I would think Dundee United will still have the biggest budget in that league. Well, that brings its own
Queen's
pressures.
Park maybe, but possibly.
we'll still have the biggest budget. So that gives them a fighting chance to go out and put a team on the park. But yeah.
And I know it wouldn't be the first time that basically when one of the bigger names from the Premier League gets relegated, chairman of clubs in the Championship say, well, I'm not spending as much because I don't think, if I spend to my limit this season, I can't compete with them.
The big fear, I think, for Dundee United is if Ross County or whoever it is, Kilmarnock, should fail in the playoff and they also find themselves back in the Championship, because they would have a comparable budget, you would think, with whatever Dundee United they're willing
especially
to throw
especially Ross County have got the, yes, definitely. The Roy McGregor
that,
money.
That could make life very difficult, but obviously that's something that's going to be decided in the coming weeks.
Well, boys, it's almost time to go, but I think last word has in this sad week, except obviously when United win 8-0 at Motherwell on Saturday. Stranger things haven't happened. I mean, Alan, it's a nightmare for you, isn't it? I can remember. I'm in the privileged position now of when one of the teams gets relegated. I say, well, so what? I mean, I'm disappointed, but it's not the end of the world. But is it, when you're going to the games home and away every week and covering it, it's a blow, isn't it?
Well, I'm slightly reluctant to paint myself as the victim.
I don't feel sorry for you, but you, what I'm saying is you get pissed off as a reporter when you're not going to the Premier League.
No, do you know what, I see I'm not the best person to ask this because I used to cover Dunfermline and Raith Rovers, and I'm very, very fond of the places, so actually I'm quite looking forward to it. But what I would say is I do certainly appreciate what supporters are going to lose, because Dundee United's away following in particular has been absolutely fantastic. For the entirety of my time working for this paper. And
they're the ones I feel sorry for, I must admit. Even as a Dundee fan, I feel heart sorry for the United fans, because at every level of the club, they've been let down.
Yeah, and I think back to when they sealed fourth place up at Ross County and the scenes there, and think back to home at Alkmaar and the amount of fans that went over to Amsterdam and Alkmaar, and even there's been so many big crowds this season, and when those big crowds and big games have taken place, especially towards the tail end of the season, they've just been such massive letdowns. The Ross County game, stands out just at Tannadice, just there when they reduced tickets to £5 and packed the place out. And as you say, you're using the right expression, the fans were completely let down. So it's a shame that those sort of away days and those sort of occasions are going to be more rare for the supporters, because they will feel like they did their time. Mm-hmm. They were in the Championship for three long years and will feel like they did their time down there, and they didn't ask for this football club to have eyes bigger than their belly when it came to recruitment and amount of money they were spending, and aiming too high and forgetting that you do need to defend sometimes. They didn't ask for that. They would have been happy with another season of relative consolidation and maybe challenging for the top six, but that's not what happened. And they're the ones that are who we should be feeling sorry for about sending going back to the Championship. I will survive.
Well, okay, Gloria. we're out of time, but Alan Temple, it's not me you should feel sorry for. It's the medals in the post.